Ladies, it's your time to shine with all things fabulous with First for Women on Afternoon Express. For insurance with a host of fabulous benefits, call 0861 111 1844 or SMS FIRST to 49267.
Coming up on Afternoon Express, controversial comedian Chester Missing and his personal assistant Conrad Koch. Jeannie has a gift for Arno Carstens. Inspirational businesswoman Julia Harmel shares her story. Gardening specialist Christian Jonker shows us some natural ways to keep slugs out of your garden. We play a fun game with our guests, and in the kitchen, we make this delicious sweet treat.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express right here on SABC3. It's 4 p.m. Thank you so much for coming back and joining us. I'm Bonang Matheba.
I'm Jeannie D.
And I'm Bonnie Booley. Now, the writing's on the wall because obviously we've got a sensational lineup for you. We've got a sensational guest list, and we're cooking amazing food in the kitchen. And obviously, there is heat.
Yes,
looking
served, darling.
You know, I never ever get violent tendencies. I never really get jealous. But today, there might be a little bit of a don't over, grab the shoes and run out of the studio. Those are amazing.
Thank you. Sensational.
Thank you very much.
And those boots are made for walking.
Yeah. Not really.
All right. So in case you're a doctor or you are part of the SAPS, I might need you, all right? So tweet us right now at Afternoon Chat using our official hashtag Afternoon Express. But let's see who's in the lot today.
I can't even speak from the excitement because we have South Africa's quintessential godfather of rock and roll in the house, Mr. Arno Carstens.
Mwah, wonderful to be here.
Thank you so much for coming to join us.
How are you, Arno? Darling. Good to see you, darling.
Is he not just the best?
He's amazing.
Basically, we have the best human being in South African music here today. Jeez. And you're going to perform.
Yes, I'm going to do a little song for you guys.
Brilliant. And your son is a beautiful miniature version of you, and he's ever so stylish.
Yeah, you know, he's 3 years old, and that is the best part of being a human being.
Yes, yeah. Being 3 years old.
After that, it's all downhill.
It's downhill.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, it's uphill to our kitchen because, Claire, I didn't know whether to be excited about what you're wearing or what you're cooking. But since you've got an apron on, it's fine. We'll focus on the cooking. What are we making today? Something Italian.
Something Italian. So at Woolies at the moment, it's all things Italian. So I was inspired to create something traditional, but with a signature twist to it. So awesome. We're going to make zabaglione.
Zabaglione.
Okay. I don't know if we're saying that right, but we'll pretend.
It's okay.
And then beautiful biscotti. That was where my little twist comes in, with some beautiful slow roasted strawberries. Delicious.
Awesome. I love biscotti. Mm.
So this one's a twist. This one's biscotti, not biscotti.
Is that also Italian?
Sure.
And of course, if you want to cook along with us at home, go to our website, www.afternoonexpress.co.za. But for now, back to Bea on the couch, who's cozying up with our first guest.
Thank you so much, Bonnie. Now, he's made waves all across the country with his unique brand of satirical comedy. Politicians, celebrities, sportsmen and women, it doesn't really matter who you are, he'll find a way to ruffle your feathers. Right now, I'm so excited, our first guest in the loft, very hilarious, very controversial, Chester Missing is here, and he's joined by his personal assistant and driver, Conrad Koch. Lovely to have you. Lovely to see you. Chester, lovely to see you.
Thanks, man. I like your earrings,
thank
eh?
Thank you, darling. Thank you very much.
Cotta thieves are going to steal them. They're right at Golden City. Hey, look at that. EFF will nationalize you.
You haven't even been here for 30 seconds and you're already making fun of me. But you must be quite an awesome boss to work for, right? I love your personal...
Yes, I am. Okay. Yeah. Oh, you crazy. He eats all the cash.
This is your interview after all, Chester.
Exactly. He's riding on that career. Uh-huh. Well, he doesn't treat me that well, to be honest. No, you're for real. It's like, basically, he's riding. It's like I'm Charlize Theron and he's the Noni. It's like I'm Kim Kardashian's booty and he's the rest of the Kardashians. Can we just
imagine,
do the interview?
Conrad, let me ask you.
Where are we anyway? It's the Afternoon Express. It's like top billing light.
It's going to be a very difficult interview, Conrad. But you were saying off air, you sort of have an identity crisis with Chester because people sort of refer to you as Conrad and then him as Chester and you, Chester as Conrad. How does your everyday, day-to-day life communicating with people?
He loves it. No, I don't like it. It gets weird. You know, a senior politician, Gwede Mantashe, calls me. He goes, that's how he laughs like a diesel engine, that guy. Chester, and he sees that.
Yeah.
You know, comrades, you know, because I'm the guy who drives Chester around, which is what you are. You are riding a Macri. I know, but it does get a bit controversial because, you know, when Chester got taken to court and then they sent the papers to you in your face.
down! Well, let's talk
imagine
about
if
that.
You said something rude and they sued Jeannie D.
Well, she'll just have to live with it, right?
Yeah.
But just
how... She's got one letter surname. She's like Danny Kay, the third that are along. Okay,
do you know what the D stands for?
Dad, I don't know.
Delicious. Jeannie Delicious.
Jeannie Delicious. She's tied with apple. Like golden.
That's great. But let's talk about the politicians and the celebrities, right? How do you get away with every single thing that you say to them? On a day-to-day basis, when they see you, how do they approach you? Are they even scared?
How does that work? I don't know. He's sort of got a rapport with people that he tries to be culturally sensitive.
Culturally sensitive. Yeah, culturally. Far from culturally sensitive. But Conrad, you now have a master's degree, right, in social anthropology.
Yeah.
How did your parents feel when they heard that you want to be
ashamed?
Ashamed.
Both my parents are lawyers, so that, you know, he had to talk to himself. It was only. Well, I mean, you know, it was sort of a weird job option, but you know, people make money out of all sorts of crazy things these days. Look at your earrings. I mean, they're doing okay. So they supported, I guess, because did you get it? Yeah, I did get it. This guy.
So they supported it because
this face
is literally like a laugh a minute. And you were saying they supported it?
No, they supported it completely.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't just study. I did a you know, I went and studied culture so that it had some sort of backbone.
Yeah.
He did a master's degree at a Nani Dalak University called Wits. You get Wits.
Yeah.
Just wait, bro. It was controversial because it's puppets, and you know, talking to puppets is not exactly. he's the best ventriloquist in South Africa.
He is. He
and
really,
he's also
really
the
is.
Only one.
He really, really is. But how is it on a day-to-day basis for you, Chester and Conrad? Can you tell me, you know, a day in the life of Chester missing.
When you start... suitcase, Donang. Okay, can we not get into this? He's had a tough day. He spent the whole day. His suitcase got lost. It ended up in George. George, it's actually worse outside the suitcase. Okay, there could be people from George. Sorry, George. He doesn't mean that. The whole day, I only come out when he sticks his hand in my... It's like I'm Africa and you're Western economic imperialism.
So let's say you wake up in the morning, Chester, right?
Don't you have a million Twitter followers?
Okay, I do.
George,
I do.
You take and a lot of selfies. I love your selfies.
Thank you. You follow
you
me.
Get paid. Of course I do. You get paid the selfie.
Not really.
Loaded.
Not really. If I get a selfie with you, probably we could generate some income from there.
Oh, yeah. I saw your one at the resident. That was nice.
That was nice. Selfie. Did you see that?
Yeah, he's hot.
Ended up
I like
in the
it.
Sunday Times.
Did it, hey?
Yeah.
Because I love his head. It's just getting shinier and shinier.
It's like yours.
Yeah, no. Yeah, we're trying to cause load shedding on our own. Okay,
broken. Wow. Right. But who was your favorite politician, Chester? Let me ask you. Favorite celebrity. Great. Somebody that you love. Not poking fun at, but somebody you really, really
to
admire.
To interview or just
and
that
look.
We like?
Just somebody you like.
You. Donang.
And anybody else? Politicians? Let's move into the political.
Politicians?
Who do you
like? Malusi Gigaba.
Really?
Yeah, Malusi Gigaba is a very cool guy. He gave Chester tires for Christmas. Musi, that's a lot of N's.
But I saw your Twitter wall with Sizwe Dlomo. Where did that start?
Shame. Poor Sizwe.
Yeah,
okay?
Man, you really gave
is
it
right?
to him, eh? He's fine. He's
Shame,
one of my
man.
Very good friends.
Shame.
Where did that Twitter war start?
Well,
and
everyone
how
knows
begin?
This guy's riding on, you know, this is blackface right here. No, it's not. Yes, it is. No, what do you mean? No, you're riding on my career, dude. You're like... You're like one of those white guys who wishes you with black. You're like Danny Kay with a thought. Okay, can we just...
And you no, actually...
So then Sizwe came in and said, Chester made some sarcastic comments about continuity presenters, which is just mean, you know, not
and you
saying
added
something.
Top billing presenters and then, in there
I know,
as well.
I know, I know. Yeah. I love top billing, man. Hey,
you
they
made
should
fun
rename
of
that show. Stuff you'll never have. Unless your name is Donna! No shame.
Wow.
And then Sizwe started making comebacks in Chester.
Yes.
Chester does comebacks for a living, so shame. But we're all good now.
We're all good now.
Yes. All no, right. We kissed and made up. Who's that?
Fantastic. So, woo! Chester and Conrad, you're going to, you know, hang out in the loft with us. Jeannie's here,
this
Bonnie's
nice,
here.
This is nice,
right.
There are people who've got homes that are smaller than this couch.
Chester missing and Conrad.
Holes that are smaller than your earrings.
You love my earrings.
Are you thinking of satellites?
I think I must just give you my earrings. So there you go.
Oh,
let's
thank
see
you.
If they fit you.
Juju.
All right, cool. Chester and Conrad are going to hang out in the loft with us. Make sure you don't go anywhere. Stay tuned right here on Afternoon Express.
Win your share of 4 million rand in dreams. Dial *120*762# to enter.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express here on SABC3. Things are about to get sweet and sexy in our kitchen with the first part of our recipe, Claire.
Ooh, which part sweet and which part sexy? I'm going to go sweet.
Yes, I'll go with sexy. Because as you can see, I didn't want the apron to kill my vibe, so I just put my body chain over it.
Okay, you're rocking that apron. I'm going to go with the more traditional look, yeah? To match our traditional Italian recipe.
Of course.
So, what we have here is our beautiful, beautiful, beautiful.
I know, they're so lovely.
This is going to be the slow roasted strawberries with that amazing, authentic Italian balsamic vinegar.
Oh, did you just hear my heart beating faster?
I think so. Yeah. And then we're going to move over to that, what I said earlier, biscotti, not biscotti kind of thing.
Yeah.
So just to explain that, I wanted something reminiscent of biscotti, so when you're eating it, you're thinking biscotti, but it's not that hard, crunchy, twice-baked you would normally have biscotti. So it's kind of a softer cookie that I'm still calling a biscotti because I can.
I like that thing. Okay, so what's our first step?
Okay, so you're going to start over there and you're just what we call macerating the...
Macerating?
Yeah, very, very, very big words here. It's effectively marinating the strawberries with that balsamic vinegar. Okay. They're just a marriage made in heaven.
Wow.
The balsamic and strawberry. Mm-hmm. You're going to give it sort of 5-10 minutes. You're just going to mix it all up evenly and then pop it on the tray, and then that goes into an oven at about 160 degrees for as long as you can wait. Just until they start to sort of ooze and the sugars come out and that flavor just concentrates. And over here is our butter, which we've just been creaming. Mm-hmm. We're gonna add in the sugar. That goes in there until it's nice and white and light.
Yummy. Okay, so how much of this do you want in here? Like, should I just make sure that they're all...
Okay, let's put it this way. Do you like strawberries?
I love strawberries.
Do you like balsamic vinegar?
I love balsamic vinegar.
Then just go wild. That's creaming up nicely. And then we start adding in all those amazing flavors. So we've got our almond extract. This is where that biscotti sort of influence comes in. Mm. Probably about 1/4 teaspoon.
Okay.
And then we've got about 1/2 teaspoon of vanilla. That also just a beautiful flavor going in there. It's probably a little bit more than 1/2 teaspoon, but we all get that idea. And then comes our eggs. That goes into
this. Okay.
Plop that in. And then that's just going to get mixed up over there. Okay,
awesome.
So what you're looking for over here is to pop that on the tray over the top like that.
Mm-hmm.
So if you lie it flat, it tends to stick and almost like caramelize and burn a little bit onto the tray.
Right.
When you're roasting them, you want to roast them to the point that they don't all ooze and just disappear.
Oh.
They still hold that beautiful shape.
Okay.
Okay, so that's all coming together. Let's just lift that up and scrape down the bowl. You just want to get all those sides down just so that the egg all incorporates into this. So
just
this is
all of them up.
This is gonna, it looks a little bit curdled here, don't be panicked. Once you add that, once you add the flour to it, it all comes together perfectly. We're just gonna add our salt over here to our flour, just probably about a pinch in there. Give that a good sieve.
Okay.
Make a mess, because you know why? We're gonna use that flour that's on the table later to roll out the dough, so it's not wasted.
It's not wasted, awesome. So Claire, you didn't think I was gonna help you with this recipe and not steal a strawberry.
Oh, okay, look at you now, stealing my ingredients. Lucky it's not this, because when it comes to baking, you really need to stick to the quantities. But over there, no one's gonna notice.
And of course, if you're following along at home and cooking with us, go to our website, www.afternoonexpress.co.za. And it will say there that you can steal a strawberry, don't worry.
Oh, will it? Okay.
We're taking care of it.
I'm sure I write the recipes and I don't think that's what it says.
But okay, cool.
maybe I'll add it in.
Yeah.
Especially if you've got little kids, they're definitely going to be stealing the strawberries.
Exactly.
Okay, so we're just adding some of the lemon zest in here.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful flavors again. The lemon goes fantastically with the strawberries. Okay, that goes in there. That's all of our flour.
Mm-hmm.
And we're just going to give that a good mix up. It's quite a wet dough, so it's quite difficult to handle once it's on the table, but that's why we just got some extra flour to help that along.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it.
Okay.
You don't want to overmix the dough. And then this comes off. Mm-hmm. It's not waste, because
We don't. These are going to go in the oven shortly.
Yes, that's going to go in the oven at 160, like I said, for... It depends on your oven, probably about 45 minutes around there till it's still holding its shape.
Sure.
And then we're going to add in our
almonds. Almonds, yes.
Then some of our white chocolate that we've just chopped up.
White chocolate.
That goes in there. Whole almonds, because later when you chop up the biscotti, it just looks so cool when you've got these big chunky pieces of almond
popping
in there.
Out, right.
And then, like I said, that's going to go out onto your... out onto your surface, and then we're going to wrap it in plastic and pop it in the fridge just to rest a little bit so the butter has a bit of time to harden up a bit.
Okay.
Okay.
Let's get that cool.
All that
so we need to just, what, press that down?
Just get that down. Just sort of form like a, if you will, a big cookie.
A big cookie.
And then that gets wrapped in plastic and then into the fridge and chilled. So while we put this into the fridge to chill, the strawberries go into the oven and then we wait for the next part.
Oh my gosh. As usual, this is going to be delicious.
It is going to be amazing.
Okay, awesome. So while we pop that in the oven, let's join Jeannie on the couch with her best friend Arno. And of course, Chester's going to be messing with them.
Thanks, Bonnie. Now, he's considered one of the pioneers of South African rock music, with more than 20 years in the business. His career started back in the early 90s with the legendary Springbok New Girls, and he's since released 10 albums with the band and as a solo artist. But his talents are not limited only to music. He's also an accomplished artist and actor and legend. Joining us on the couch is Arno Carstens.
Hi.
Welcome.
Wonderful, Jeannie. Well, thanks for having me.
Thank you. And of course, Chester, you're still
with
us.
I love Arno Carstens. It's the first time I've ever seen without sunglasses. I'm very excited. Ooh. Hot without sunglasses.
Here we go. He's aged nice well, hey?
No, he doesn't look a day over 31.
High five.
I can't, sorry.
Well, welcome, Arno. I think you really are the quintessential rock star. I think, you know, if back to the era when you started, you changed the sound of South African rock music.
Well, thank you very much. but you know, if it wasn't for the Nude Girls, there was many other bands, but it was amazing to be part of that whole, 90s movement or whatever, as Mandela came out of jail. There was just this wonderful feeling in the country and, yeah, we rocked it, you know.
Yeah, you really did. I mean, I'm sure Chester went to many Springbok Nude Girls concerts, as everyone did.
There would be Nude Girls. I was always led astray by that. There was just this hairy guy that he rocked it, man. You're a legend.
Yeah, well, thank you, Chester. But there was a lot of people that was very disappointed that there wasn't any Nude Girls. But we made up for it in certain shows.
Yeah.
What would have been one of your favorite Springbok Nude Girls moments or songs?
Well, just Arno Carstens' whole rocking vibe, and then he's been owning it forever. I mean, literally, music concert, like concert after concert. I mean, those all around, all the festivals, I know, and then the rocking the daisies back in the day.
And of course, Jeannie here then with us at Rocking the Daisies.
Yes.
You did Jeannie with us.
Yes, I was
amazing.
On stage.
What a moment.
With him. What a moment.
What did you do with
And her? Now we have a new album, which is, of course, this, Lightning Prevails. The sound is somewhat different. So how would you describe the change from Arno Carstens in Springbok New Girls to now the solo Arno Carstens with Lightning Prevails?
Well, I think it's a little bit more experimental. Of course, it's very toned down.
The cover looks experimental. Wow,
yes.
That's amazing.
Exactly.
Eh?
The cover should always represent the kind of music. And then, of course, you know, I also want to grow with my audience. We're getting older and stuff, but we still rock. That's why I'm in the studio now and then with Theo from the Nude Girls. And we're busy recording some new stuff. Let's see what happens.
Now, Chester really likes your cover. And do you know who the artist is of the cover? I'll give you one guess.
His three-year-old.
No, I'm sure he might have inspired it a bit. But Arno Carstens, you did the cover.
Yes.
No, it's very good. It's very exciting. It's very impressive.
What a lot of people don't know
what
about
did you
is
do
that
with it? Is that watercolour? Did you Photoshop with
Whose
oil?
Whose interview is this?
Coffee stain.
With oil, Chester.
I love the genie. Oil, is it oil? Wow.
Okay, so what a lot of people don't know is that you actually studied graphic design before you went into music. So art has always definitely been in you. You're certainly very creative.
Yes. I wanted to do fine arts, but my parents in those times, they said, no, you should do something where you can make some money out of art. And you're not going to make money out of fine art. So that's why I had to go do graphic design. But I didn't do well with it. After the army, I just wanted to party, man. So Yeah. I sort of partied myself out of studies.
And that just didn't stop.
What does your first painting look like?
Pretty much like that.
No, for real, how old were you when there was a first initial painting and you thought, okay, this is good?
I think all around from 16, 15. 16, you start really developing your own fingerprints and your own way of doing things. So, and like I say, I haven't really changed much. I'm really lucky that I've got my own style.
So where do you find that you draw inspiration from for your paintings and for your music?
Actually, just from your head and everything subconsciously, what goes on in the world and stuff like that. That's where I draw it from. And then I throw it up in the air and see what happens.
Because I remember on one occasion, we were sitting at your home in Cape Town and we had a wonderful, glorious lunch and we had a few glasses of wine and you pulled out an easel and some canvas and you came to me and you said, right, we're going to paint. And you went and you started the canvas and then you gave the paintbrushes to me and then you handed them, and we created something quite amazing. You really did inspire me, and I think collaborations are always really strong. So I've created a little something that I thought maybe we could use.
Awesome.
And I painted this. It's called, it is a self-portrait, actually, the ultimate Springbok nude girl.
Oh, wonderful.
And so, as you can see, she's me. And
that is incredible.
She's a Springbok nude girl. Unfortunately, we had to censor it because this is a family show.
Oh, well, this is going straight to my pool room.
So, is that going to make the pool room?
Yes.
Okay, so we're not going to sell it yet at your exhibition just yet.
Oh, that's beautiful. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for chatting to us, Arno Carstens. You are the best. Don't go away. When we return, we check in on those slow roasted strawberries and we give you natural remedies for slugs.
South Africa, are you with us?
Welcome back to Afternoon Express on SABC3. Ready for part two of our lovely, delicious dish with Claire right here in the kitchen. So, how do we start off the zabaglione?
Oh, good one. I think you might pronounce it better than me, and I don't even know if I'm pronouncing it correctly.
But for anybody that's watching, what is zabaglione?
So it's a light custard. There's lots of airs whipped into it. And okay. That's what we're going to do over here, and you're going to get working on that.
Aha!
Get those forearms going.
I'm ready. So where do I start?
So we've got a pot that's just lightly simmering. You don't want it to be bubbling over, otherwise you're actually going to make scrambled eggs.
Yes, all right.
Okay. So that goes on there. As soon as it goes on there, you get whisking.
Okay, so there we go. And then I just whisk.
And then we're going to add in our sugar that pops in there and just keep whisking. And then what makes zabaglione so traditional is that you use masala, which I don't know if you know, is the color of the year.
Oh, really?
Interesting fact. So another cool interesting fact about it is that you get three different shades of masala. Mm-hmm. So you get the golden, the amber, and the ruby. The ruby is actually that color of the year. It's that like dark port kind of color.
Okay.
So this is the amber masala.
And then why that particular one for this recipe?
That's traditional. So it's a good, authentic, traditional flavor.
All right.
You don't have to add it. You can add your own thing. So a French version of a zabaglione is the sabayon. Mm-hmm. And you can add all sorts of flavors into it. Just vanilla essence even. It's fantastic.
I was about to ask, can you substitute it and traditional vanilla?
And then you just keep whisking. And then while you do that, like I said, it's going to take a little while. You're going to be working those forearms properly. Got our biscotti, not biscotti, over here. It sort of looks like a cookie dough. And that's going to be a little bit firm now because we've had it in the fridge. And we're just going to roll that out a little bit thinner just so that it doesn't take years and years to bake. Mm-hmm. And then that'll go into the oven. So you just cookie cutter it out, or you can even just make a nice big one like this and just break it up, tear it up into your dessert.
Uh-huh.
And then the almonds just pair so beautifully with that masala, with the strawberries, which look fantastic in the oven. You can see they're still holding their shape. And they smell so balsamic-y and good. Okay, and then we're just gonna cut these out. The almonds do pose a little bit of a difficulty when you're cutting these out, so I just like to press down nice and hard with a dish towel, and let's pull our tray over here. It's almost gonna form like a cakey cookie that we're gonna pour the zabaglione over and then pair it with those beautiful strawberries.
Okay. I was about to ask Claire how long you have to whisk and how you know that the zabaglione is ready.
Okay, so you can see how the air bubbles are almost disappearing. They're much thinner and smaller than they were. Once that kind of puffs up and you've got all big, fabulous, pillowy air pockets. Okay. That's what you're looking for. Probably about 10 minutes.
Okay,
it's,
cool.
It's a long time.
It is a long
so
time.
So if you can, use your electric blender, electric mixer. You know the ones you just hold over.
Oh, yes. That is it. Wait, Claire, girl.
I don't know, I thought it'd be fun to make it work.
All right, and those go into the oven, you said, for 15 minutes.
Yes, probably about 12 to 15 minutes, just until they get a little bit golden on the top. Mm-hmm. And you can see how much it actually makes. I should have got a bigger tray.
Yeah. And then no egg wash, nothing on top there?
No, just as it is. And you don't have to waste this. Just form it up again. As long as the dough doesn't get too soft from the butter, you're fine. You just keep forming it and just keep flouring the surface, and then you can make as many as you want. And then that goes into the oven.
So they will be ready just before the end of the show today.
Exactly. Fantastic. Just in time for us to place it all up and start digging in.
All right. And don't forget, if you want the recipe and, of course, the shopping list, log on to our website, www.afternoonexpress.co.za. But while I whisk and while we pop those into the oven, let's go check in with Bonnie, who's standing by in our outdoor garden. How are you doing there, Bonnie?
So you've planted that organic garden and you've bought your new pot plant, and then to your dismay you notice your plants aren't thriving and there's holes in them due to slugs. So joining us today is our gardening expert, Christian Jonker, who's going to give us advice on how to fight those creepy crawlies. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Awesome. So what are we actually going to use to fight these slugs? And where do they come from? They just appear out of nowhere.
They do. They seem to do that.
Yeah.
To answer your last question, they usually come from the nurseries, without the nurseries even knowing that.
Oh.
You know, you get little eggs and stuff in the soil or under the leaf that nobody can actually
spot.
Like
little babies hiding in
yes,
the corners,
yeah, like
right?
Silent assassins. Yeah.
Silent assassins,
yeah.
Okay.
You want to obviously steer clear from pesticides, you know, the commercial pesticides,
yes,
which harm, especially if you've got a veggie garden. You don't want to spray all sorts of things that you didn't even know about onto
right.
your veggies.
And if you've got kids, because, you know.
Or dogs. I mean, sometimes, yeah, some things are quite lethal to dogs.
Okay.
So what we're going to look at today is actually organic and natural pesticides.
Okay.
Not to kill them, but just to wade them off.
Yeah, keep them away.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
Okay, but I mean, you're keeping them away, not to kill them, but where are they going to go? It's the rest of the house.
You just have to extend your defenses.
Exactly. Okay, so what ingredients are we going to use to make these natural deterrents?
Well, let's say there are three different ways that I'm going to show you today.
Okay.
The first one will be companion planting.
Mm-hmm.
Then we have physical deterrents, like
okay.
barriers.
Right.
And then we're actually going to make an organic spray with household items.
Awesome.
So I think the first one, yeah, we've got a lovely arum lily. Still quite young. You know, we want it to flower, we want it to shoot, we want it to look
yes.
lovely. But as you can see.
And I see it's quite holy. Yeah.
Yes, it's very holy. Yeah. What caused this would most likely be your slugs and your snails.
Yes.
Or your caterpillars.
Okay.
And caterpillars and slugs and snails all come from the base of your,
okay.
of your plant.
Right.
They, you know, they live in the soil under a rock
okay.
where it's moist and whatever. And then at nighttime they'll creep up and destroy
do their thing.
All the foliage.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to not set a trap, but make it impossible for them to actually reach the top.
Oh, wow.
There
okay.
are a whole bunch of ingredients. And what I've got for you today are coffee grounds,
uh-huh.
chili powder, and another thing we can use is self-raising flour and eggshells.
Hey. So we just use that in our recipe in the kitchen.
Okay, cool.
Hold on 2 seconds. B,
yeah.
Could you please pass me those eggshells and that self-raising flour,
babe? Of course,
babe?
Darling. Of course, darling. There you go.
Awesome. Thanks, love.
Great. Fantastic. Things are perfect. Yeah. So I think what we'll demonstrate is the eggshells.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. And maybe while we prep these, I'll explain the rest.
Okay, cool.
Okay, cool.
Well,
so
how do you prep
you
them? Crush them?
Crush them, yes, please. Yeah.
Okay.
It doesn't have to be very small, but, you know, just a decent size. Coffee grounds are a good thing because they deter snails and
mm-hmm.
also cats. And it also, a bonus on the coffee grounds is it serves as a very natural compost for your plants.
What's in the eggshells that actually deters them?
Nothing. It's
really?
Just a sharp surface, and they don't like that.
Right,
you know, slugs
right.
having a slimy
they don't
underbelly.
Have to navigate all that.
Exactly.
Sharp.
So when they get over it, and they immediately don't like it, turn around and look for something else.
Okay.
I've
of course now got egg yolk on my fingers,
but
all for a good cause.
Great. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. So basically, what you do is because they come from the bottom, all we're going to do is grab a handful. I see what you mean about the yolk.
Yeah. I'm like.
Yeah. So
okay.
all we do is we'll spread them around the base of the plant. And
right.
create, you know, an impenetrable, impossible barrier.
Okay.
And that's it. And likewise for the chili powder and the coffee grounds. Sprinkle, you know, a hefty layer around the base.
Yes.
The self-raising flour, on mm-hmm. the other hand, actually gets sprinkled onto the leafy parts of the plants.
All right.
If you've got cabbage and you've got caterpillars eating the cabbage. So you would sprinkle that early in the morning, and then the caterpillars come out to feed. That's their prime time.
Okay.
And then they'll eat the leaves and eat the flower along with it without noticing. And as the mercury rises, the temperature gets hotter.
Oh, wow.
The self-rising flower expands.
You mentioned another way is companion planting.
Yes.
What is that?
If you identify a particular pest, mm-hmm. let's say, for example, slugs and snails,
okay.
You find out what they don't like. One thing we do know is they despise garlic.
Okay, so you would grow a garlic plant and put it amidst all your other plants.
Exactly.
To deter
if you've
it.
Got
okay.
a pot, you can plant a small little garlic in that mm-hmm. pot. If you've got a veggie patch, why not plant a border of garlic around? It's a perfect way. And then at the same time, you've got this added bonus of garlic,
awesome.
You know, for the kitchen.
Yeah, you kill two birds with one stone.
Precisely.
Okay.
So there are a number of different items which you can use,
yeah.
which have different capabilities and different properties. So for example, we've got marigolds.
Marigolds, yes,
lovely,
yes,
self-seeding,
yes.
they spread mm-hmm, on their own.
Mm-hmm.
It's a great deterrent for flies.
For flies?
Yes. So you don't even have to plant this in your veggie garden, you can plant it on your windowsill. Rosemary, fantastic,
right.
you know, dual medium, you can use it for cooking,
mm-hmm.
and the fragrances also, just some pests
amazing,
and insects
yes.
don't like it.
Mm-hmm.
And the added bonus is you actually bring bees and ladybugs, and that feed on the aphids and whatever.
Okay.
And the same with lavender, obviously great smelling, you can
mm-hmm.
actually take the flowers, dry them out, put them in a little bag, hang them inside, great scent, also
right.
keeps away the flying insects.
Awesome.
So maybe if I could show you,
okay.
here we have a lovely chili plant. Not affected as of yet.
As of
but
yet.
We want to
okay.
keep it that way.
Okay. Yeah.
So here I've got small little garlic, which you can just buy at any nursery.
Right.
So what I'll do is I'm basically just going to. Proximity isn't really a factor.
Okay.
They will grow to a certain size, but they won't, you know, expand or intrude and invade on your particular plant.
Mm-hmm.
So all I'll do is I'll just open up a small little gap here.
Wow, I'm smelling that biscotti coming from the kitchen. Sorry.
I smell it as well.
It smells amazing. Okay.
And then these are still very, very young. Oh, tall. Then we can get as much out of here as we can.
Here we go.
Hey.
How many would I need?
Just one should suffice.
One's fine. Okay.
And obviously, as with everything, it's trial and error.
If you see that you're not winning, try something else.
If you see that you're not winning,
okay.
double up or try something else.
Okay. The other thing you mentioned was a spray.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, yes.
How do we make that?
Okay, so this is a pretty basic and pretty broad, you know,
mm-hmm.
insect. It's not. Yeah, you could call it an insecticide.
Right.
It doesn't kill the pests, but like I said, wades them off.
Okay.
And it's not harmful to your plants. We'll need basic household ingredients,
right.
which makes this so easy. Garlic.
Garlic.
Some chili powder. The
mm-hmm.
hotter the better.
Okay.
And the final ingredient is sunlight soap. If we could mix all of this into that little jug, mix it up overnight.
Okay.
You know, to seep.
Awesome.
But,
let's do it.
What we'll do, if you could
okay.
start there and I could bring the rest.
You can pour the rest of it while I
sure.
pour the garlic. Okay.
Yeah.
We've got our garlic, we've got our chili,
mm-hmm.
now our sunlight powder.
Sunlight
well,
soap, yeah.
Soak.
Yeah.
Awesome.
So the sunlight soap actually acts as a contact agent. It actually helps stick to the surface of the leaf and creates a film.
Oh,
yes,
yes makes
yeah.
sense.
And because insects breathe through their skeletons, this actually creates a layer and suffocates them.
All right, wow.
Yeah, so, yeah.
Okay, I think we've got enough in there
that
for now.
It should be enough, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Right, let's go to an ad break while I get that going. And of course, you can always just get rid of the soap and use this as salad dressing. Welcome back to Afternoon Express. We're on the couch with myself, Bonang, Conrad, you, Chester.
That is such
she
an
doesn't know your
you
name.
Know
what the thing
what
is,
are you wearing, Jeannie?
You know
what
it's,
is that around your neck?
It's quite,
you're wearing half of London.
It's quite controversial,
Anglo-American
actually,
shares in your neck.
Chatting to Chester because he's always dissing us.
Always.
Yeah, and
was,
Bonnie.
But he was
I
saying,
apologize.
Yeah, he was saying
sorry.
The nicest things about you earlier on when I was chatting to
no,
him.
No, when Jean. I'm not in the room. Nice
yes.
one.
Yes.
We also have Arno Carstens on our couch, and we've chatted to him about his art and his music, but now's the time to put him to the test.
Yeah.
So how well do you work under pressure, Arno?
I don't know. It's in the eye of the beholder.
Okay.
All right.
So do you think you'd be able to handle if we put you under immense pressure?
Well, you can only do what you do, and I think this probably, there goes my career.
All right. We played this game a couple of weeks ago with Miss South Africa, and she did very, very well. It's called Pictionary. All right? So, Jeannie, Do you want to tell him how it works?
Yeah, you are going to have a look at what's in here. And there's your board. Here's your words. You've got 1 minute to get through as many cards as possible. Drawing what's written on the card. Yeah. We're going to move opposite over there, and we've got to guess what you are drawing.
And you're not allowed to say anything.
Yeah.
And you're not allowed to spell or draw alphabets.
Yeah.
All right.
Not allowed to write anywhere.
Good luck.
Okay.
Don't show us.
You can't see. Okay, come.
All right, come.
You pass us.
Come. Okay,
go. We're not looking.
Here we go.
Okay. Come. You can also
what,
do this.
Can I also do it?
Yeah. Woo! And your time starts now.
Go. All right.
I can't see the board. This is not going to work. Oh, no, I can't see.
I can't see.
That's your problem, man.
Shoot. Skate.
Come on, get on my boots. Am I right?
Steve Hoffmeyer.
Is it a saying? Is it a word? Is it a lightning tower? A person?
10 seconds. A stick man.
A light. Ning Tower, Stickman.
Balloon.
Man with a balloon. Man with a balloon in his hand. Man with a balloon at the Bonte with the lightning in Bonte, Johannesburg.
5, 4, 3, 2.
Terrible.
Your time is totally up and. Wow, Arno, this is now embarrassing because.
Okay, so what
were they?
Okay, so that's. It looks like eggs, but it's rock and roll. You see, there's the little thingy going. Rock. But how do you?
Rock and roll.
Yeah. That is.
A man with a balloon.
Well, Pictionary. okay, and then a high voltage.
High voltage?
Yeah.
This is embarrassing.
This
because
is terrible.
Actually, I've painted you as like a really, really top artist.
I told you, there goes my career, man.
That's terrible.
I certainly hope that you are better at singing than what you are at drawing.
You guys are now, terrible.
This is the man that has toured and performed with the Rolling Stones and with Celine Dion, with U2, with you name it. So we have him live in our loft today, and ladies and gentlemen, singing his amazing single,
Rely On.
Oh, I love this song. Here's Arno Carstens.
In your everlasting quest to find a mountain you'd love to climb, the sucking friends in a bulldozed mind. Me, on the other hand, I'm unkind. An opponent. That's how you'd like to think about me. But I hold on. 'Cause I know one day you are gonna come around. Ooh, 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 ooh. I'm a train, I carry all your pain. A steel tongue with a nine lung. A world at ease as a quiet dawn. One-legged crow on your window pane. Someone to rely. I'm a train, I carry all your pain. The best is yet to come. On the beat, right in front of you. A new world is down and down and gone. And whatever. On the beat. Careful what you wish for. On the beat, that guy's yawn and yawn and yawning. On the beat, just keep the moaning going. On the beat, make yourself a widow for a baby, yeah.
Open up into a door, a doorway open up to suffer no more. Cloud of joys, man, me don't mind. I know life can be unkind. Cloud of joys, man, me don't mind. I know it's unkind. Sweet caress on the broken bones. On the other hand, I am stoned. Someone to rely on. Someone to rely on. Someone to rely on. Someone to rely on.
Star
in the country.
Incredible.
Well done.
Well done. Thank you so much for coming. Wow. That was fantastic.
Thank you.
That is why he will always be one of our legends right here in South African music. Absolutely incredible. Let us know how you love that right now on Twitter at Afternoon Chat using our official hashtag Afternoon Express. But don't go anywhere. We're going to keep on inspiring you right after the break.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express here on SABC3. Her story is an inspiring journey from rags to riches and a woman who would not take no for an answer. From humble beginnings, she now has her own business called Global Focus Events Management and Catering. Joining us on our cast to share her wonderful story is the inspiring Julia Harmel. Welcome to The Loft.
Thank you, Bonnie. Thank
it's lovely to have you here.
Thank you.
Cool, so let's start at the beginning. Where were you born and bred, buttered and toasted?
Well, I was actually born in Langa. Mm-hmm. And my parents moved to PE. And then after they divorced, my mother moved back to Cape Town. And that's how we ended up in Cape Town.
Right. Okay, so your catering and events company is now global and it's doing really well. But before you started that business, you were interested in wine.
Yeah.
Tell us about
that's
that
a,
wine
that's
journey.
A very interesting story.
Yes.
I left a marketing job to crazy times. I was single. I was didn't have any kids. So I walked out and I actually thought, I'm going to actually export South African wine to the rest of Africa. Uh-huh. Little did I know, you know, I made very few mistakes. I used my own money, right. Traveled all around Africa and actually found buyers and distributors. Mm-hmm. I came back thinking that this is all going well. Then find out South African Wine Society was a very close
right.
society.
It's also a boys' club.
Oh, yeah, God, it's a boys' club. It's unbelievable.
So what were some of the challenges that you faced?
No one wanted to listen to you. If you were not known within the boys' club, no one wanted to actually pay any attention to you. So I lost a lot of money. I literally became so broke. I went back to stay at my mother's house in Khayelitsha. From living in Mule Point to back to Khayelitsha in my old room.
That must have been quite discouraging, but what got you out of bed and on your feet again and trying again?
It was. I kept on hearing my former boss saying, I'll give you a month, come back. And to me, I don't...
Come back to your old job.
Come back to my old job. He was still offering. So to me, this was, if you say that to me, you're daring me. And I'm going to be so determined to actually keep on trying until I achieve. So I kept on hearing his voice saying that you need to come back, give you a month, but I was like, this is not going to happen.
Right.
Little did I know that was going to take 2 years. Two years of nothing and 2 years of actually knocking on every door and no one listening. So one day I get a call. Uh-huh. One of my former clients from the same company saying, look, we've got delegates. We'd like you to actually entertain them and actually throw an event. And me being me, I was like, okay, I'll do it. Mm-hmm. Didn't have a cent, not one single cent.
Wow.
So I did what I did best. I put on my best suit, I went to see a bank manager. And I got into this bank and I asked for the bank, you know,
the bank manager.
For the branch manager, for particularly, branch because manager. I knew they'll send me anyone, everyone else, and I, no one's going to actually hear the story the way I want to actually, you know.
Tell it. Right.
They sent consultants, they sent everyone else. I said, no, I want to meet this particular person. Eventually, when he realized this woman wasn't moving.
After how long?
The whole day.
You waited the whole day?
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
If I had left, I was going to be on the street. So eventually he comes down, it's time to go home. Yeah. This woman's not moving. He says, what do you want? So I had a whole day to tell him exactly what I wanted.
Right.
I want to apply for a credit card, I want a bank account, and I want an overdraft.
And when do I want it? I want it now.
Oh, yeah. Oh, God, yes.
And then?
And, but before then, the FICA laws were not, you know, in place, and he said, okay, seems like you know what you want. Obviously, he does your background check, and I said, before you do that, just so you know, I have no money. I have nothing.
It's just zeros.
The only thing I have is the promise from this client saying that I have to do the event, and it's next week, but I need money now.
Wow.
By the time I left, I had applied for a credit card. I had a bank account, mm-hmm. a business bank account. Mm-hmm. I had an overdraft.
And then you had money to go home?
I literally walked out of the bank into the next ATM, withdrew money to get home.
Oh my gosh, that's incredible. Gosh, yeah. So what are you up to now?
It's been a journey. Mm. We're celebrating our 10 years this year.
Wow.
10 years into the business. It's been an interesting journey, one that has actually taught me a lot of things. Along the way, we've grown. We've managed to grow even in the, you know, most difficult time, you know times. It's been an interesting journey, one that actually, you know, you look at it and I'm like, if I knew what I know now,
yeah,
I would have never had the guts to actually walk into that bank and
be so fearless.
Yes.
What advice would you give to young female entrepreneurs who are starting from scratch, who are going through all these challenges and wanting to give up?
Focus. But focus, you know, lots of temptations along the way.
But determination.
Determination.
Yeah.
Define what you want in life. Define what you want to achieve and be good at it. That's success.
Thank you so much for joining us. Your story is truly remarkable and inspiring.
Thank you, Wally. Thank you for having me.
Of course. Anytime. We want you to come back. In fact, we want you to stay for dessert.
Oh, my God. Oh, really? Yes. I'd love dessert.
I think things are just about ready in the kitchen. B?
Thank you so much, ladies. Now, we're back in the kitchen with Claire as we finish up our delicious meal today. What are the finishing touches?
Okay, Claire? So all your hard work has paid off. Show us those muscles.
See, jeans, I can pick you up, baby.
I know. Okay, so you can see how beautiful and ribbony that is. Uh-huh. That's what you're looking for, all that air just coming into that.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're really just going to start dishing up.
Hey, okay. Just in time for of the course. Dishing up.
So just break those, yummy. Like I said, biscotti, kind of not really a biscotti.
All right.
And then,
right.
Jeannie, you can pop the strawberries in there, and then we're going to dish up.
Well, Arno, Conrad, Chester, Claire, ladies, thank you very much for joining us right here on Afternoon Express. And thank you at home for interacting and watching. We'll be back on your TVs on SABC3 tomorrow at 4 p.m. From all of us right here in the loft, it's good evening and happy eating.
Coming up tomorrow on Afternoon Express, comedian and author Stuart Taylor talks family and career. We take a look at celebrity must-have baby items. Sibling models, the K2 twins, join us on the couch for a chat about the pressures of growing up as a twin. We take a look at canine physiotherapy, live performance by Mafiki Zolo, and in the kitchen, we make a lamb neck and creamy garlic rigatoni.
Another feel-good production.
Join us next time for more fabulous fun inspired by First for Women on Afternoon Express. For an insurance quote, call 0861 11 1844 or SMS FIRST to 49267.